Hey, this is my 77th show, and I'm excited because this is one of the people I consider my comedy baby, and I just love his energy. I'm so super proud of his accomplishments, and I've been running around doing errands today. Hey, let's see. Design a Rose Interiors and Video Lady, how are you? We're getting started in just a second, waiting on my guest to pop in. I've been trying to get ready for tonight, but I had to run around and do some stuff at the hardware store and also interior store. And so, let me bring on Big Fred. I see him now.
Hey. How you doing?
Hey.
Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you. What's going on?
Oh, nothing much. Nothing much. I am going to introduce the show. Then we're going to get started.
Yeah, let's get started.
I am Charmel McMillan, and I am the author of the best-selling book, Just One Thing, forward by Mike Epps. And I created a show or a platform here that mimics my book, because my book talks about my life-changing moments, defining moments, times when God stepped in. I didn't know how things were going to come together, but God always has a plan that's bigger than what you think you want for your own life. And so I decided the best way to perpetuate my blessings was to celebrate other people's lives and their highs, their lows, their fears, their frustrations, but ultimately finding their destiny and walking into that thing that God has for them. You know, we're always on a path. It doesn't feel like it sometimes, you know, but our journey is always in motion. And so those stumbling blocks are really stepping stones and everything you're meant to be. So I am so super happy to have my guest tonight. This is my 77th episode.
Come on, that's a good number. Fred,
Fred Watkins Jr. Let me tag this so people know who you are and what I'm talking about as we go on.
Okay, absolutely. Look, number 77. Make sure you put that in there. Shout out to Smooth. What's up, everyone? Getting on. I'm so happy to be here. Just One Thing. Amazing book. This woman is amazing, and she's definitely a mentor of mine. So I'm happy to be in a building.
Well, I'm happy to have you. And so I didn't ask you for, like, you know, bullet points like I asked some of my guests for, because I watched you over the last, I think, almost 10 years, you know, evolve.
Yeah.
And I remember,
It's been some time. Yep.
I think it's been almost 10 years, hasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
10 years,
yeah,
something like that.
Yeah.
So it was a minute ago, because I know I just lost 2 years with COVID. So, you know what I mean, with the whole pandemic and everything. So I know I lost 2 years. So I know I've known you long before that.
Fact, I'm celebrating my 2020 birthday next year. We ain't doing it. I'm not.
Man, I was supposed to celebrate 25 years in entertainment last year. The venue, everything was secured. Had to cancel it all. This is 26 years. So I'm gonna celebrate 25 years at some point.
Exactly. It wasn't a cancel. It was a postpone. That's
right. God's timing is perfect. And so I didn't ask you for bullet points because I've watched some of your trajectory, you know what I mean, in the entertainment industry especially. Now, I always start off asking where people are from. Where are you from?
I'm from East Baltimore, Maryland. They call this one of these hills. You know, it's a lot of hills in Baltimore. I'm from down the hill, USA, Baltimore, Maryland. I'm from Baltimore.
Okay, and you grew up, are you an only child? You have brothers, sisters, what do you have?
Rest in peace to the original Big Fred, my dad. He was a Rolling Stone. My father, he had a marriage before the marriage that created me, and he had, he had adopted 4 kids. He had 3 also. So when he got married to my mom, he had me and my older sister, my little brother, that's 10. And then at his funeral, it was just this young lady in the bleachers. It was like, hey,
Not in the bleacher.
You know? So I'm one of 11. Now I got a lot of brothers, sisters, nieces, and nephews. I was the one that got like all the nieces and nephews just older than me. So they used to carry me and call me Uncle Fred, you know, feed me and all.
Oh,
that.
Wow.
Yeah, used to be cool.
So you had the Brady Bunch plus five. Okay.
Oh. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We never talked about that, but I always think the foundation of our childhood, you know, it lays how we see life and perspective and things of that nature. And so, you know, I know the Bible says, you know, train up a child in the way they should go. They come full circle back to what you ordained them to be, or, you know, guided them to be. So what was Fred like as a kid?
Talk too much, inquisitive, a lot of questions. Pretty similar now. I had my shy moments. I always wanted to do something, but I didn't know like what I was talented. I even went and auditioned for the talent show with no talent. And when it was my turn, all the spotlight was on me. And I just, you know, I think I said something. It was like the Sister Act 2. They had a little quick excerpt from Lauryn Hill's song. I sung that.
Okay.
I sung that. It was about 3 seconds long. If you want to be somebody, if you want to go somewhere.
Is that how you sang it? Is that how you sang it?
Kinda, and that's why, you know, they told me to go back upstairs. So, you know.
Well, clearly comedy is where you were headed.
Yeah, man. It's crazy how that'd come back and hit you. Even in high school, I remember we went on a tour at the Apollo, and it was multiple tours, probably about like 100 different people, and they asked everyone in the main auditorium, like, yo, you know, who wants to perform in front of all these people? It's about 150 of y'all. Mm-hmm. And different groups too, all different places. And I just wanted to be back there by the tree trunk. I never knew if I would have another opportunity to touch the little trunk. So I raised my hand. They brought me back there. I'm looking at Michael Jackson, all the grad Tupac, and they like, yo, what you gonna do? And I'm like, shit. I forgot I asked. So I said, yo, I'm gonna do comedy. I'm gonna tell some jokes. They're like, you gonna tell jokes? I'm like, cool. Went out there, did a hot 3.5. Uh-huh. It was hard. People was laughing. And I totally forgot about that moment until like my 30 in comedy. I was like, boy, you know, you performed that day.
Wow.
You know, you did comedy. You did this already, shorty. So it's crazy. Just like you said, the stuff that happens as a younger person, it really sets that foundation.
So when you were younger, what was one of the defining moments in your life?
Wow. Oh, man. I'd say my father passing, my father transitioning, honestly.
Okay.
Because that was that big level up. Like, I felt like I was only 10, but I felt like I had to, like, grow up fast. And, you know, just being in my neighborhood, my mother, you know, now just, like, a single mom, like, essentially, you know, a widow. Like, you know, I felt like I had to step up. So that was definitely a defining moment.
So you really struggled with that for years.
Absolutely. Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
Definitely. Yeah.
Because I was under the impression that he passed away when you were a little bit older.
Mm-mm. He passed away when I was 10, May 5th, 1999. My mom just got on. What's up, Mom? What's on? Love you, baby. That's my queen. Yeah, he passed
away. And Miss Watkins, how are you, love?
Hey, girl. He passed away May 5th, 1999. And yeah, it took a while. It definitely took a while. I had my lumps, you know, growing up. You know, just missing rough times. I got locked up. I got like false accused for like 7 charges. I didn't do Grand Theft Auto, all kind of stuff. And just
how did you get falsely accused for stuff like that you didn't do? I can't hear you. You cut out.
Yeah,
I got you now.
Wrong place, wrong time, Shaw Boogie. You know, just being a kid, and that's one of the reasons I'm so passionate about youth now, because it's so easy to just make that wrong decision and that wrong turn, just being in the wrong place. And my mom told me, it was probably like 11, you know, and she was like, yo, don't go outside, boy. And, you know, I wasn't listening. I still went outside, and it was a car accident around the way. Everybody always go to the accident. Like, you know, in the neighborhood, you always go to the stuff you're supposed to go away from. So we hit a car accident. Me and all my guys get up. We running towards the accident. We don't see it, though. It's around the corner. We running towards the accident. When we get to the corner, we hear these gunshots. Bow, bow, bow. We like, oh, no, turn around. We ain't going to run to that. So we start running back towards the crib. I don't know why, but I always been different. I always went a different path. Usually, that's a good thing. This time, it wasn't. Everybody else ran one direction. I ran a different direction. I look to the left. It's like 3-4 dudes running next to me. I'm kind of chilling, jogging. They running for their life. So they run past me, police officers swerve around, jump out the car on some, you know, movie, whoever, you name it, John Travolta, he puts the gun out, he like, freeze. So I stop. I'm like, oh, man, look, I ain't no snitch, but I'm kind of nudging like, yo, they went in the alley, shorty. Like,
so you really didn't do anything?
I didn't do anything. He said, I said, stop effing moving. He was talking to me. He clipped me. He had a steel toe boot, kicked me in my head. They couldn't give him resisting arrest for anything because, I mean, they couldn't give him any charges. I couldn't do anything about those charges because he said I was resisting arrest. And he was the only one right there. So I was lumped up and everything, but he said I was resisting arrest. They picking me up. They like, man, how could you do this? And then they asked me questions. And they like, yeah, you a hell of a driver, man. How old are you? I don't know what's going on. I see the helicopter in the sky. They finally take me around the corner. Mine just been an hour and a half process. Never made it around the corner. Finally take me around the corner. I see a dude on a stretcher.
Wow.
It's a dude on the stretcher. It's a car accident. It's everything, man. They charged me with all of it. Grand theft auto, unauthorized driving, possession of a deadly weapon. They charged me
good
with it.
God.
Like, yeah. Like, it was wild. Everybody in the neighborhood, man, you know, advocating for the young brother. He was just out here. He ain't doing all the mothers outside. He, you know, that's Fred. Man, they wasn't trying to hear none of that. It was that officer word.
My God.
Yep.
So did you end up having to go to jail for a little while, or what happened? How did you get away from that? How did you get off?
They kept me for a couple nights. I was traumatized. I couldn't watch Set It Off for like 5 years. Then they basically when it came time for trial, I had a public defender, but luckily I had some help in the community, right? And that's one of the reasons I became so passionate about community. My public defender basically lied to my mom. He was like, yo, I got to talk to Fred by himself right now. You know, I can't have you, you know, right there. And my mother, you know, she trusted God. She was like, okay, cool. God took me in the cut. Like, look, man, this in the trial, right before the trial started, took me to the cut. Like, look, man, the judge, she's a bitch. He was like, she don't like black people. Something. He was like, yo, you could take, he was like, we can fight this. And if you get found guilty, that's 7 years. Or we can do this thing called a plea bargain. And you won't have to get any jail time, but you'll do this much community service. So I'm 14 years old. I'm like, no jail.
You're only 14?
I'm only 14, right? And he took me to the cut and all that. Said, gave me this by myself, right? Mother over there, looking at my mother. I want to make her proud because I made her so sad and embarrassed. So I look and I'm like, man, I'm going to take that plea. I told the man, thank you. I thought he held me down. I said, man, thank you, bro. Because when you're that young, you only operate in jail or no jail. You don't think that's it. So I'm like, no jail, man. I got that. So I had to do all this community service with it. And I was guilty until I was 18, right? So this is before high school. So even going to high school, everything, my whole life after that, still had that associated with my record until then. So I had so much community service I had to do, but it's like, yo, where you gonna do that? But it was a community center in my neighborhood. You know, I was already affiliated with family, you know, whatever, summer camp. So I started, you know, spending a lot of extra time there. And to be honest with you, that's really what started to grow and nurture my love for community, youth, and everything. So it's no coincidence I founded a nonprofit. It's no coincidence that we're in the community the way we are, because technically community saved my life. Like, good people in community programming saved my life, definitely.
Wow. So what happened next? Okay, so you're 14, and then you get through high school. What happens next?
All right, so at the high school, we go to Morgan. I'm so lucky. Shout out to
my alma mater,
Morgan State University. I'm so, because being from Baltimore, right, you know, I went to Mervo right down the street. Shout out to three champs, big Mervo. You know, our first championship, we excited about that.
Right.
But we slowed down. They told us back then, you know, everybody used to say Mervo was like 13th grade. I mean, Morgan was 13th grade because it was so close. I'm so glad I didn't listen. Because I got the Earl G. Gray's Business School Scholarship just being ambitious, because my grades weren't necessarily like that, but my network, you know, I would get move around and put myself out there. So I got in kind of on that tip, and shout out to Tex Dean. And I was just happy because it was really like 10% Baltimore to me, especially like freshman year, and everybody said it was 13th grade, but I'm looking around, I'm like, nah, y'all tripping. I don't know these niggas.
Right.
I'm meeting people and everybody. And I remember even I got like enamored in that coach. I'm from East Baltimore. I'm from like down the hill. And I'm standing on campus and it's different, right? So I remember my barber, I told him, I was like, y'all owed him $10 or something. And East Baltimore. And I remember talking to him on the phone. I was like, bro, when I get back in town, I got you. He was like, look, I had enough of you talking about this in town stuff. I drive past your dorm to go home. He was like, but it felt like you was somewhere different. Like, so I embraced it fully. He like, man, I drive past Morgan every day, man. You talking about when you get in town, man, come get my $10. Stop playing with me. But yeah, so went to Morgan, did that, and founded, you know, an organization with my guys at Morgan Smooth. Still more community, more just just an outlet of always having a heart to like serve and wanting that platform, you know? Mm-hmm. And yeah, it wasn't even comedy then. I broke my neck at one of the homecomings, and that's how I started comedy.
You did what now?
I fractured my neck, my C4 and C3 vertebrae.
Jesus.
And that's how I started comedy. I fell into depression. Watching Roast on Netflix brought me out of the depression. Of course, God brought me out of depression, and I said that I would have a neck release party when I got my neck brace off, like an album release.
Neck release party.
Like an album release. So it was the roast, and the roast was lit. Everybody
So let me say hi to Terry S on vocals, amazing vocalist.
What's up?
How did you break your neck at homecoming? Because I've been to a lot of homecomings, more than you, and I've never broken anything. How did you... You know, because I mean, I work with a lot of comedians. I started out with comedians. I work with sports figures and everybody else, right?
Right.
But, you know, comedians tend to cut out the details when they tell me the story of what has transpired. You know, like one time, one of my comics, national comedian, I'm not going to say his name, but I was managing him at the time, and I didn't hear from him for 3 weeks. You know, he just disappeared. I couldn't reach him at anything. So he finally reached out to me. I said, "Where you been?" He was like, "Jail." But let me tell you how good God is. No,
tell him
why
you were in
jail.
Praise
first.
Him. Praise him. Yes.
So I know how y'all do me. I think, no, tell me why you were in jail first, then tell me your testimony.
Yeah, then praise him.
So then he said he was in jail on some bullshit. I was like, first of all, bullshit is not illegal.
Some bullshit is.
So anyway, how did you break your neck at Morgan State's homecoming? Because I've never broken anything at a homecoming. I've been to a lot of them.
Oh man, look at show. Look, so I was broken neck Fred for a minute. So basically homecoming was dope. And you have been to more homecomings than me, but I don't know how many after parties you've been to. I was at a homecoming at the party, my own self-prescribed at the party. And
when you say self-prescribed, this something you threw?
Yeah,
or this is an interlude after homecoming.
Let me give you the real breakdown.
Yeah, give me the real.
Give you the real. So basically, we were having a party, right? So we left homecoming. We all get ready for the party. We all talking. We can't wait. Got a couple of homeboys. They horse playing. One of them like 330, meaning 330 pounds. The other one, he weighed bigger than me too. They horse playing. They playing with one of the guys that's probably about my size, smaller, right?
Okay.
He beat the guy up. I'm looking at him. You know, I'm big. Yo, we about to go see these girls have a good time. Y'all playing. Y'all chill out, man. Down chill. So I get tired of watching the skinny dude have to go through all this hardship. I get up like, you know, because I know me. I want to help him out. Get up. Y'all don't look at me like that when I'm telling a story. So I get up, right? I get up. I say some skinny nigga chant, like, yeah, we ride together. And I take one of the big dudes, actually clip him, right? Win for Fred. He hit his head. He rolling around. I don't see him rolling around on his head. The other guy is 330. I see his arm coming. You know, the grandmother's Thanksgiving was a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, I do.
He got the grandmother arm. So the grandmother arm coming. I duck and put him in the rock bottom, shout to Dwayne Johnson. But then I realized that he 330.
Okay.
Once I realized he 330, I ain't picking him up. He start laughing. He kind of picks me up. I'm trying to tell him to put me down. The guy that I dropped on the head in the first time, my first win, he rolls into his legs. I fall, hit my head first, and his whole 330 like goes opposite of where my body was. Boom. It got real bad fast, y'all.
Oh, my God.
Check it out. Didn't go to the hospital. Had a concussion.
So you had a broken neck, fractured in two or three places, and you didn't go to the hospital?
Mm-mm. Didn't go to the hospital. Had a concussion. God saved me, because you're not even supposed to let your friend. All y'all on this live.
God is like, take my name out your mouth right now. Because I have nothing to do. Keep my name out your mouth.
Many of your friends have a concussion. Don't let them go to sleep. You're not supposed to let them go to sleep. So they let me go to sleep. They go to the thing. I wake up in the middle of whatever. I don't know what's going on. I can't really move. But I'm popping tags, though, because it's homecoming. You know, you always get a refund check by homecoming. So I'm popping tags. I'm picking up stuff, putting stuff on, can barely move, get in my car, can't even really look left, but I'm driving because subconsciously I just...
You're driving with a concussion and a broken neck.
Yeah, because the doctor said that with my concussion, he said I just wanted to, like, just do... So I was kind of, like, mildly, like, slow. Real, like something. I'm
tarded.
Yeah, you know, I just, you know, you got sponsors. So I'm driving around. So driving around the city, everything closed. So I'm like, damn, y'all want to have some fun. So this is where my self-prescribed at the party came. It's probably like 3-4 o'clock in the morning. Call my young lady friend. I'm like, hey, you know what you're doing. I pull up, and what ensued after that, I don't know what in a concussion would make you want to make somebody ride your face. But I hope my mother's still not on this. But basically what happened was,
I'm going to tell Ms. Watkins if she is. I'm like, ma'am.
After the conclusion of this, the next day, everybody was saying, yo, you need to go to the hospital. I'm like, man, I'm good. You know, people always think they know something. Nobody was telling me nothing. They just was like, yo, you need to go, you need to go. One listen to them. By the end of the night, one of my guys that was a nurse student, like a pre-med something, he said, Fred, oh my gosh, the way it's swollen right here, look like you got a clogged artery in your ventricle. I said, all right, that's enough. Went to the hospital. I lied to you not. They came to me. They said, we know you're in immense pain, but everything was negative. We're going to subscribe to these Percocets and, you know, whatever. So I'm sitting literally at the edge of the bed, legs swinging like a little kid, just waiting to get this prescription so I could leave, right? Swear to goodness, real story. The doctor came back in like a freaking soap opera. Two nurses came in. They grabbed me. They said, please don't move. They put the neck brace on me and move me back. So I'm thinking maybe they just want me wear it for a couple days, take it home. They didn't bring it up. But I'm like, all right, cool. I'm with that. Cool. I'll take you home. The doctor came in with the clipboard. He's like, Mr. Watkins, I'm sorry. I apologize. I'm like, oh, what's going on? He like, I don't know how we missed this, but essentially you broke your neck. I looked at the person I had with me, looked at the doctor. Damn, that faint.
And you had a concussion.
Woo! Yeah, woke up in the MRI. It get a little worse after that, but as far as that was it.
Got worse?
Broke neck Fred.
What got worse after that?
Oh, I was just being a player at the time, and I got a little caught up in the hospital. It was just one of the worst days of
my life. So you were being a player with a broken neck and a concussion.
I was being a player before the broke neck.
Okay.
When the broke neck came, that's when all the game erupted.
So people tried to come and check on you.
Yeah.
So there was a meeting.
Big meeting. You know, when you on the meds, you just want
they wanted to break
friends.
The other part of your neck.
when you on medication, you just want everybody to be friends. You know what I mean?
So you you tried to bring everybody together.
They off the meds. Like, listen, y'all need to talk. I don't know what was going on. Somebody should have been there to stop me. I don't know what I did, but it was the wrong thing. But I was in there. And I don't know who I thought I was, but it ain't working the way I was intended for it to work. So yeah, I was in two different types of depression, but comedy brought me out of both.
Okay.
Most definitely.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. So I don't even know if I want to ask what's the next defining moment, but
no more riding faces, no more broke necks. Everything else cool. We good. It probably get a little bit. Yeah, it's nice. Everything cool after that.
Well, I met you. It was that during a homecoming weekend.
I believe so. Yeah, the comedy.
And it was because Joe Claire and Eddie Bryant were performing. And yeah. I think you either hosted or you did a guest spot. I can't remember. Mm-hmm. And that was the night we met.
Yeah. Man, that was a magical night for me, Shaw. I mean that. We talked for a long time. I appreciate
yeah,
that.
We talked at the table because they had them, you know, cafeteria tables in there in that auxiliary room.
Yeah, they got another shout out to, never mind. Go ahead, shout out to
you. You know my Ray Diva.
No, I was going to say shout out to the PPP because the Comedy Factory got new furniture now.
Yeah, they do. I mean, I've been there now. I mean, but they got it like within the last, right before COVID, they got new furniture and stuff.
Right. That's why I said shout out to PPP loan.
Oh yeah, they did. They got a lot of stuff going on. But no, we were sitting there at the table talking, and I don't know why you came over and started talking to me, but you did. Mm-hmm. And then something that you said or something hit me spiritually, like later that night after I left the Comedy Factory, and I called you.
Right.
And that's when we had a long conversation. So I felt like I was connected and watching your growth and everything you're becoming now. Like, you know, I'm so proud of you and the work you're doing in the community, the what you're doing on stage, how you've evolved into this, you know, thing I knew you were going to evolve into, if that makes sense.
Thank you. I mean, that's what you told me. A lot of the context of that call was to, like, prepare for what was coming. And I appreciated it. Like, God, like, allows, I think, breadcrumbs sometimes to let you know that, you know, some of your direction or part of your direction is the right the right path. And I'm telling you, that was one of them. That was one of them. And so much of what I've been allowed to do over the years, us being able to stay connected and check in when we do, is definitely like more breadcrumbs for real. Yeah, you know.
Yeah, I call it glimpses of greatness. What'd you say?
I said, you know, you the big homie.
I call it glimpses of greatness. I think God shows you just enough so you don't give up.
Absolutely, absolutely.
You know. Absolutely. So what's popping now? What's been going on since the broken neck and the evolution in college? And I've seen the evolution in comedy. I've seen you grow. And I was like, I remember that first night I said, people want to hear what you have to say. And this was like, right. I guess almost 10 years ago. Other people want to hear what you have to say. You got the energy. Now I just need you to focus in on letting people get to know you and telling your story and connecting with the audience. So what's the evolution been like?
Man, evolution has been amazing. I think it's definitely prepared me for the work that we do with youth, for the work we're going to continue to do with other comedians, other just thought leaders, to be honest, public speakers. Because one thing I learned in comedy, when you're funny and people tell you that you should do comedy, like, yo, you should do comedy. The goal is to stay in some way, shape, or form that person that people love and relate to, and it's like doing this funny, right? And a lot of times people will say, oh, I'm doing comedy now, I gotta become somebody different that's a comedian. You know, like I gotta tell jokes, and you'll find yourself sometimes leaving like the person that everybody was like, yo, you need to do comedy, you funny as hell. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I think for me, even now, I think even after these years, I think my greatness is evident, because the first couple of years, I think I became a good comedian, but I wasn't me. You know what I mean? I became good at like doing that. Good at making people laugh, or, you know, in that way, but it wasn't me. I wasn't really telling my story. I wasn't being myself. I wasn't felt.
But you were what they liked.
Absolutely.
Is what I was saying. I said, I liked you, but you just need to connect to them and bring them into your world.
Absolutely.
You know, and now you're doing that. And you're an amazing storyteller. Like tonight, I was genuinely cracking up when you talking about your tragedies. But I mean, you know what I mean?
And they were sissing too, so they were sissing tragedies. I ain't give it to you. You know what I mean? I ain't give it to you where I could have gave it to you.
But you're a great storyteller. I was like, that's material. That's what I was sitting there thinking. Oh, shout out to Ben Stevens, my friend, star of Family Business, Carl Weber's Family Business on BET+.
Ben Stevens, what's going on, bro?
And so, I mean, I love, it's something that's going on now, and I don't know what it is, because I'm not around you as much because of the pandemic, so I can't see you. And I can always tell when I see you. But I see there's an energy around you. There's like the eye of the tiger. Like, you are going after it. You are getting it. Everything you were created to do, you are getting it.
Absolutely. I think it's a lot of energy that was really suppressed. When we did that reality show, did the Oxygen reality show, we won that, and a lot of people were like, yo, you need to go ahead and dip, like, you're in Baltimore, move to LA, move to wherever. And I really felt, for whatever reason, at that moment was the height of starting Lil Laughs. It was like, yo, while you on TV, shorty, you could be in the community, and then people could see you on TV, but you're in the community. Like, you always want that, and always felt like you wanted that for our stars or our legends, but you had the opportunity to do that now, so that's what I did. I was like, yo, no, I'm a volunteer, and I'm gonna get in the community for real. So that's what happened. Like, I remember walking up an alley with one of my guys, and unfortunately, he's in jail right now, but at that time, he was trying to do something different, and he was volunteering with me, and I remember he looked at me, he was like, bro, and it was a Tuesday, the show came on Oxygen that night, and we in East Baltimore, like, down the hill, just walking. He was like, bro, I've never met somebody like this humble. And I'm like, bro, it's not as much as humility as it is just confidence and belief, like, that I can be here and still be there. Like, it's more like the audacity, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, it ain't as much humility as you think, you know what I mean? It's belief in us. Like, it's no difference in that. Like, you know what I mean? This is what matters, you know? And that's more so what it was. I just thank God for that opportunity and that lens like that, because the energy that you're talking about now is really from just finally just having that confidence and that ownership and just the path that, you know, that was intended for me. When we decided to start the nonprofit, like, a lot of people that don't really know, they love me, was like, bro, what you doing, shorty? Like, you're young, this is prime. Like, you starting a nonprofit, that means no money. Like, Like, right. Think. Like, think, bro, what you doing? People with good intentions, some people, you know, whatever, but it was just so much that I had to kind of block out and stay in this city and to also try to craft something that I didn't go to school for. Mm-hmm. Some innovative comedy infused youth development. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I wear so many hats. And next year, I'm finally excited to start really getting them hats off me. I said earlier, I'm going to pass them out like Oprah, like, you know what I mean? To the right people. But you get a hat. Right. Like, you get a hat. You want a hat, shorty? I've been watching you for a while. You get a hat. Like, I'm trying to get it off me something.
Yeah, having the right team is essential. And I'm not saying that tongue in cheek. I think people in, you know, especially this industry use the term team, overuse it. But I really think that people who partner with you and work and help make the bottom line happen and make it greater is essential. You know, so if you can find that, that's indeed a blessing in the next level.
Absolutely. So I'm looking for, we're extending our board for Little Laughs this year. I'm really excited. Well, next year, I'm really excited about that. And I'm just moving forward, even with what that allows me to do. Like, I've been faithful. I've been steadfast. So I'm looking forward to what's coming next, because even wearing all these hats, like, I haven't, you know, I don't complain. It's a blessing. And we're in a position for people to be able to come in and take this thing to the next level. And that's amazing. That's amazing for me, for them, for kids, for educators. Definitely.
Just inspiring vision in young people. So I see your post and creating opportunities for them and making them see sides of themselves they didn't realize they had. I think that's what it's all about. You know, and doing that as your own career flourishes is even a bigger blessing. Sometimes people wait until, you know, they fully feel like they're at whatever, you know, level that is, that they feel like they're supposed to be at to make a difference. But to be making a difference and, you know, carry them along on that journey with you so they can see your growth and see you, you know, achieving your own goals is a blessing.
Yeah, absolutely. And like I said, like, you know, some of these cliches are really like, really like profound. And that whole be the change you want to see. Like, we all have a life, like we all have a shot. And it's really, really easy to talk about, you know, other people or what you want to see or what someone else isn't doing, and almost to the point where you forget your own, like, ownership in this. You know what I mean? We all are on the same world, on the same earth together. So I really wanted to do that. Like, I wanted to use myself to kind of spark that. So when I'm now challenging other people to do more, or challenging people to, like, be able to grow, but at the same time be intentional in the community as well, like, there you go. Like, I'm a blueprint. You know what I mean? I ain't telling
exactly.
Exactly.
I always say, you hasn't happened yet. You are your blueprint.
Most definitely. Yeah.
People always looking for examples, and I'm going to be like so-and-so. You hasn't happened yet. Just do you, you know, and do that thing God put on your heart.
Absolutely. Yeah, now, I mean, that's what we do. So I'm thankful. I'm thankful. It's a fun journey.
I know it is. It was fun watching you. And so I'm super proud of you. Anything last minute you want to talk about or tell people about, or, you know, any other life-changing moment you feel like you need to share before we close out?
So look, y'all, look, this is one thing that people don't know. I don't do too many of these. Just like you heard about the jails and stuff and all that. What we do, our services are very, very, like, y'all need to tap in. We do a teacher comedy workshop. But from doing that teacher comedy workshop, it was so fun for the teams and everything, and they loved it that we just opened it up to all teams. So all you all that's out here, that are staff people or executives, we can come into your office space, give you a comedy show, bring it to you. It's fun. It's funny. You got budgets for it. It's team building. It's morale building. It's essential. And some of those proceeds go to our nonprofit Little Laughs to keep that going in schools. It's really innovative. So tap in now while it's early and before we get booked up.
Okay, that is dope. Fred, I am so proud of you, and I'm always so excited about everything you're doing on and off stage. And so, continued blessings.
Shaw, thank you. Thank you for all you do. Y'all keep supporting Shaw. Man, she's amazing. And Shaw, like I said, God use you. You're a breadcrumb. Thank you for not what you just do for me, but for the whole industry, for the culture, for everybody I don't even know.
Thank you.
That's just what you do. You feel me?
You got to walk in whatever your calling is. So, you know, you be a conduit for other people's faith.
Amen.
So anyway, I'm super proud of you. This is episode 77 of Just One Thing. And I will be here tomorrow night. I'm one of the most phenomenal women I've met in a long time. Media mogul, author, motivator. She does so many things. I think she owns how many radio stations does she own? I can't remember, but she's a beast beast. And so we've been friends for a while. And so I'm rarely in awe of people, but I'm in awe of Josefa Salinas. So she will be here tomorrow night. And so join me at 8 o'clock on IG Live for that interview. And it's going to be a good one, you know. So she has a lot of stories. She's overcome a lot. You know, the Bible says to whom much is given, much is required. So she's been through a lot, but she's also been extremely blessed and been a blessing to thousands and thousands of people. So please tune in, Josefa Salinas, tomorrow. Thank you, Fred Watkins. I appreciate you. I'm Charmelle McMillan. It is, and just one thing, the show.
Just one thing.
Check out my book.
Y'all have a great night. Thank y'all for tapping in. Aisha, I'll see you.
All right. Have a blessed one. Bye-bye.